Welcome to CIO Leadership Live Canada. I'm Lee Rennick, editor of CIO.com, and I'm very excited to welcome Rex Lee, Chief Information and Technology Officer, Canadian Tire. Thanks for joining us today, Rex. Please introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your current role.
Great. Thank you, Lee. And thanks for hosting me on this call today. So I very much appreciate it. So as you said, I am the Chief Information Technology Officer at Canadian Tire, which means I'm responsible basically for everything to do with technology across the family of companies at Canadian Tire. So that would include Canadian Tire Retail, Sport Check, Mark's, Party City, PHL or Pro Hockey Life, and several other banners that we have.
So a really large portfolio, an immense and different amount of retail brands that you're working on. Well, I really appreciate you joining us here today, Rex. As you know, we've created this series to support the CIO and senior tech leader in their leadership and business journey. So the first question is always around that. Can you please share and tell us a little bit about your own career path and maybe provide some insights or tips on that road path? Were there any specific lessons learned you could share?
Sure. I'll try to keep it brief. There's probably three big companies that I worked with that have really shaped my career and lessons learned from all of these. I really started off my IT career with Bell Canada, and I had recently graduated. I had done my MBA. I actually wasn't thinking about IT and tech. I was actually thinking I was going to lean towards more of the marketing side of things. But for some reason, tech always drew me, and I used to get interviews for technology roles, and I landed at Bell Canada, and I thought I would be at Bell Canada for about 2 years. It turned out to be 12, and there's just so many opportunities, and I got to do so many different things, and I still look very fondly back, all the great mentors that I've had and opportunities that I've been able to be a part of. I would say from Bell, multiple things that I've learned. One of them was breaking rules. So I sometimes ask folks, when's it appropriate to break a rule? When the rule doesn't actually achieve what it was intended to achieve, you know, it forces you to rethink about the rule and what we're doing. When I started at Bell, I was in this horrible location outside these glass doors in a cubicle. And at the end of my row was just a big pile of old PCs. And it was horrible because people would forget their badges. They would knock on the window and they'd say, "Hey, can you let me in?" And they'd see me there. So I'd have to get up. I'd have to go over there. I'd, you know, ask them who they were. But I got to meet everybody because of that, which was great. I took it upon myself at one point to take those old computers, and I built a server. Wow. And then with that server that I built, taking apart old computers, I then networked it into our network at Bell and created shared capabilities, which we didn't actually have readily available way back then. It was great for information sharing and sharing of documents and collaboration and those kind of things. I got in a little trouble. Apparently I wasn't supposed to take apart equipment and hook it into the network and create privileged access and all those kind of things. But it got me noticed in some positive ways as well. And sort of thinking outside the box of what my day-to-day job was, just saying, well, there's a better way of doing this was something that we were able to do. Lots of great stories of Bell. I was there for about 12 years or so and just really, really learned so much and just loved that company. From Bell Canada, I then went over to Research in Motion, which is now BlackBerry. And right. It's interesting because I went to RIM, my first meeting with them. They actually brought me over, the salespeople at Bell Canada who were looking to sell services to RIM, brought me over to explain to them that we actually do this stuff internally, how we collaborate, how we build these technologies, how we think of social computing and these various things. And so having a practitioner speak to it was more powerful than just having a salesperson speak to it. So they would bring me over and say, "Hey, how'd you do this?" It was a great meeting. I loved doing it and sharing a lot of the great things the team had built for years. And I got a call shortly afterwards saying, "Hey, really interesting stuff. Not sure we want to buy the services, but we really want to talk to you about how do you do this." And it was it was just such an amazing opportunity. Like back in those days, you know, basically the offer was whatever you want to spend, whoever you want to hire, whatever you want to buy, you can do it, whatever you need.
Wow.
Like what we want is we want to build a collaboration capability for our organization that's growing so quickly. You don't get those opportunities very often. Even with that, because I loved working at Bell, I wasn't inclined to leave. Eventually I did. And it was just, again, an amazing, amazing experience. I probably wouldn't have left if I didn't get another phone call. But, you know, my time at BlackBerry was amazing. You know, there's so much that's been written about the demise of RIM and BlackBerry. And in my opinion, a lot of that is just oversimplified. You know, people say things like they weren't innovative enough or they didn't see Apple or, you know, these kind of things. Being on the inside, I learned a lot. I learned about the problems of having too much money and not enough governance and control. And when you have unlimited resources, like I did, you're able to just do stuff. But constraints actually force you to do things differently and right. force you to really go, huh, maybe there's a better, smarter way. But when you don't have those constraints, you tend to make decisions which are fast and easy as opposed to really innovative and creative. And so huge lesson learned from me as I saw that. It's just one, there's several things. It's much more complicated than most people would say on the surface, but it was a lesson I'd learned from my days at RIM. And then I got a phone call from an old boss of mine that was at Bell Canada. He went to a different company. I went to a different company. Eventually he landed at Canadian Tire. They asked him to transform the organization from a technology perspective. He called me up and said, hey, are you looking to make a change? And I wasn't, but he was very convincing. And then I moved from telco to tech, high tech to retail. And I didn't think I would make that jump. I didn't think retail would be something that would invigorate me, but I was so wrong. It's so exciting. Like on the technology side, I didn't realize how embedded technology was in everything to do with retail. And so I was hired to do quote unquote digital transformation. And the definition back then was implement e-commerce. And you know, it was funny because there was this perception that e-commerce was just, you know, piece of software or something you implement, when really it is a radical business transformation. Every yeah. aspect of your business changes yeah. once you start to go down that path. And so that led to a variety of other things and gave me an opportunity to do more and more. And eventually I was given the opportunity to take on the chief information and technology officer role for everything that we do.
What a journey. And when you said you started off wanting to go into marketing, I feel like throughout all of this though, because I am a marketer, right? I've been a CMO. I feel like throughout all of this, you kind of had your marketing hat, a little bit of a marketing hat on there, because you were going in with the sales pitches. You know, you were experiencing and looking at like earned versus paid media, but you were doing it from the standpoint of technology innovation. So I feel like it was partially there too.
I got to tell you, so I have an MBA in marketing and IT and technology management, and the marketing side has been so helpful on the technology side and vice versa. And so it's really helped me in many ways.
Wow. Well, that is an amazing story. And thank you so much for sharing that. So wanted to pop into question number two. So you work at a very iconic Canadian brand, Canadian Tire, celebrated 100th year anniversary last year. Congratulations on that. And certainly it's been embedded in my own culture and growing up in Canada. I think, you know, for most of us, right, that we feel very that it's a very iconic brand. And so, but I wanted to talk to you. And one of the reasons I reached out to you originally, because I was talking to another VP of tech about the pandemic. And he said, you know, do you know Rex Lee? I reached out to him at the start of the pandemic because I really wanted to get some networking support and learnings on how we're going to pivot around this. So I was just wondering if you could tell me about any lessons learned during the pandemic, you know, for the technology leader. And did you see more networking, more of an agile approach, given the way the world had to adapt so quickly?
So yes, yes, and yes on all those fronts. So many lessons learned. And those are the type of things where you don't really realize until you're in it, just how amazing things can be. And so just to put a little bit of context for us during the pandemic, When the government shut down all of our stores, we were not deemed an essential service. So that meant shutting down all of our stores in Ontario and Quebec. That meant all traffic from a retail perspective went online. We were doing in Canadian Tire Retail about 5,000 orders a day, and we got flooded. Well beyond anything we had possibly imagined in terms of what we had built the system for. We were doing about 120,000 orders a day. And I used the car analogy to help people understand just how hard of a problem this was. Because if you're doing 100 kilometers an hour, if you wanted to do 120, you just step on the gas pedal a little harder. But we're talking 2,400% increase. Mm-hmm. That's going 2,400 kilometers an hour. Pushing the gas pedal harder doesn't get you there. And you need a brand new engine, you need new tires, you need new drivers. And it's not even fixing the car. You got to fix the roads. You got to change the traffic lights. There's so many things that have to be changed. We literally had to do thousands and thousands of changes every week for us to eventually figure out how to unlock the scale problem that we had. And it was extremely difficult to do. I felt very personally responsible as well for mm-hmm. putting the corporation in such a challenging position where revenue is just not coming into the organization. I remember sending an email message to our newly minted CEO. He had only been a CEO for a couple of days before the pandemic shut down everything. And saying, I felt bad and it's on me and we will figure this thing out. And he was great and just he thanked me for the message. And after we got through it and we figured it out and he sent me a beautiful, beautiful note. And I said to him, thank you. I think we probably could have solved this faster if I didn't get so much help. And, you know, my point being is that it was very public. And it was very, very challenging. And a lot of people jumped in from all over, vendors and, you know, people. And some of them made some big claims of, well, we could solve this. We could fix this.
Right.
Which was somewhat ludicrous because they had no idea what the real problems were. We're a 100-year-old organization. Not all of our systems are very modern. And because of that, the complexity of some of the legacy infrastructure, which held back our ability to achieve what we needed to, required really deep, deep, deep undertaking to sort of resolve. So lessons learned. It's amazing what happens when you empower people and you trust them. Bringing in more people when the problem was something that was very unique to Canadian Tire slowed things down, didn't actually help, created more confusion and more people as opposed to just trust the team, let them go. If I look from a sort of people process technology framework, you know, other things we learned on the people side is we didn't have to compete with priorities. You know, the number one priority is get money into the company, get it up and running. So there was no sort of debate. And nor was there debate as to, well, gee, you know, should this be capital or should this be OPEX? And what do we do this? And the willingness to take risks, a lot of the structures and the things we do in the organization, every large organization, turned out that not all of them add value. And we were actually able to bypass many processes and still achieve what we needed to achieve, still do the right things from a risk perspective. But it really helped us sort of rethink a lot from the process perspective. And one of the, I mean, the last point I'll make, we can go on and on just about this one question, Lee, is on the technology side and how technical debt can be a problem. And in our case, the technical debt led to our inability to scale, ensure stability under high volume, high pressure. And that if we were able to think about the next 100 years, we're going to have to get ahead of some of these things. And so it was a great opportunity for us to learn from a technology perspective, how do we think about adaptability and agility as well? I lied, maybe one more thing I'll just talk about, and that is the operating model and how people worked. There was no real IT and business. It was just all one team. We all worked together. We all had the same goals. I felt so supported by my peers. Sometimes technology gets blamed for things. It's, oh man, technology, you guys in technology, you did this. But everybody realized that it was the situation. How do I help? What do we need to do? And very supportive. And so that actually accelerated. We were already down this journey, but it helped accelerate the move towards an agile operating model where you combine business and technology teams under single structures, single squads, with product owners to achieve common objectives. And so it just helped reinforce the power that can unlock.
Wow, what a story there. And, you know, it's interesting you say, talked about the car, because I was talking to another CIO who said, the CIO right now, since the transformation, the pandemic and everything that went on, is really had to jump into the driver's seat of the car. Yeah. Like, that's the analogy he used. Like, we have to be in the driver's seat. We're driving it. We're trying to figure out how to accelerate. And as you were talking about it, I was thinking you were talking about the business transformation as far as sales go, but you had a whole bunch, lots of employees, you know, that had to be supported through that transformation as well, right? So many organizations had to support that, going, you know, shutting down stores. I mean, it must have just been an incredible experience for you. So I really appreciate you sharing that very, very much. So wanted to talk a little bit about shared knowledge across the organization. Maybe you touched on this already, but you hold two titles at Canadian Tire, the CIO and the CTO. And so I just was wondering, now that you've gone through this pandemic experience, how you implement shared knowledge across teams and management, really to funnel that into the business and make it one place. Some of the CIOs I've talked to talk about, you know, huge tech Kanbans and different approaches to information sharing. Any tips or advice around that?
Yeah, well, that's a great, great question. And yes, I kind of hold two roles, the CIO and the CTO role. And I think it's a bit of a trend. We've seen this happen in many other organizations. I'm sure you've seen this as well. The idea being that technology, whether it's sort of internal facing or customer facing, has certain constructs that can be applied more broadly speaking. And if you're able to unify these things, you can actually harness the power of economies and longer term thinking and greater scalability in the long run. So my role is not just the operations and how things work today, but also what's next, what's customer facing, and how do we evolve and what's innovative? And so how do you bring those two things together? So a big part of this is, how do you communicate? How do you align? And how do you build that rapport? And how do you make sure that we're doing the right things? And it's interesting because a lot of organizations have evolved, through traditional IT, and it's really a separation between sort of what is IT versus what is the business. And so as organizations continue to mature, that sort of dissipates to some degree. So IT people become a little more business people, and business people become a little more tech people. And you know, the operating model that I talked about really, really does help. I believe that you need the tone at the top, and you need to have that opportunity to be able to bring things together. And so our CEO does exactly that. I'll give you an example. Cybersecurity. Is something that is a challenge for every large organization these days. And sometimes it's seen as a technology problem. And so technology team, IT team, cyber team, go fix it. And it can't be done because it's not a technology problem. It's a business problem. It's a business imperative. And so in order to align, you have to create OKRs, objectives and key results, that are shared. And so it's not my objective, it is, but it's not just my objective around cybersecurity, but the chief marketing officer, the chief finance officer, the chief HR officer, they all have cybersecurity in their objectives. So the tone at the top says, okay, we're all in this together. How do we work? And so that is sort of a starting point. Without that, it's really hard to create alignment and communicate. Those shared objectives are so powerful because then we know, you know, we're all working towards the same thing. The other piece, and maybe this talks Lee a little bit what we were chatting about earlier on some of my marketing background as well. In communication, the ability to listen and deeply listen and really understand sort of what are the outcomes that we're trying to achieve? What are the root issues that are preventing us from doing whatever it is that we need to do? And then how do we talk about things that aren't so technical, that are more business focused? And so we talked about the car analogy. We could use other analogies. So one of the challenges that many IT organizations, especially public organizations, have is the impact accounting and finance has on technology investment, technical debt, and technical complexity. And so you can talk about OpEx and CapEx. And OpEx is typically seen as a bad thing. It's seen as overhead and inefficiency and, you know, all those kind of things and a drag on a corporation. Whereas capital is often seen as a very positive thing. It's an asset. It's creation of something, a capability. It's possibly innovation. And so it's seen as a good thing. So it's still the same money. If it's $100, it's $100. But if one is seen as negative, one is seen as positive, then you're probably going to want to spend on CapEx versus OpEx. But you can make bad decisions because of accounting versus technology decisions based on technology. So as I explain this concept to the board, because it can get a little technical points, is I talk about how it's easier for me to keep buying new cars than it is to fix the car that I have. Coming back to another car analogy, we are Canadian Tire, by the way. So it's easier for me to buy another car so I can do something versus fix the car that I have because I have money, but it's ridiculous. I don't need five cars. I only need the one, but because I can't get money to fix the car, I'll just go buy a new one because I can afford that. It makes no sense at all. And so using the power of storytelling and analogies is really helpful in sort of making sure that you get that alignment, and then focus on outcomes as opposed to focusing on tasks and activities. Telling people you got to patch a bunch of servers, you know, that doesn't really get you very far. Explaining what risk is being mitigated and what that would mean to their business, our customers, much more powerful.
So what I'm hearing, this is an amazing conversation, by the way. Thank you. What I'm hearing here is like, okay, so you did your MBA. So did I have one too. You're putting on your finance hat there. So you really are. When we talk to people like you, you really are taking on the full business role and really understanding the finance. And like, again, the marketing aspect, learning how to interpret information and make it more usable for someone else, you know, the sales aspect, or if we have to buy this, or if we want to sell more of this, how does technology impact on it? So I appreciate all the ways you've shared how you work in that area. We have one last question, and it was around cyber. You touched on it briefly, but, you know, my question says, we've talked about the changing nature of cyber. I think cyber is just ongoing. So let's not say changing, but ongoing. And just, you know, the need for collaboration and education around cyber. Could you talk a little bit about that as a leader? Like, how do you manage that ongoing and permanent nature of cybersecurity? And you did touch on that a little bit, but if there's anything else you want to add there.
Sure. It's, it's on the minds of everybody. It's on the minds of boards everywhere. And there's so much, unfortunately, that's been going on, especially in the last little while in within Canada as well. It does start with this acknowledgement that cybersecurity is not a technology problem. It's a business problem. It's a business issue, a business imperative. And that helps set the tone. And what we've done at Canadian Tire is we've actually embedded objectives across all of the C-levels. And so if we say it's everyone's problem, then let's put it in everyone's objectives. It just makes sense. That is so helpful because now everyone is, well, how do I, you know, do what I need to do? And we'll help you with that and we'll figure it out. And a big shift has to happen in terms of what you're looking at. And it needs to be focused on outcomes. And so from a business perspective, so many cybersecurity programs, they focus on tasks and metrics and maturity models, explaining sort of a CMMI, 2.6 versus a 2.8 is really, really hard to get people to actually care. But when you talk about the likelihood of business disruption or the likelihood of physical harm, because of operational technology, these autonomous vehicles, drones that are used, robotics within distribution centers, all these things can kill you. Now we've got cyber at such a different level. And so when you start to explain it in business terms around residual risk and cyber risk scenarios, that is our North Star. And so in cyber, you often hear the adage of it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. And it's a good adage and very true. I mean, when the world's best of the best can't completely defend, what makes you think that you're so much better than everybody else, any organization of scale and size? So you spend a lot of time then talking about what is the North Star, and whatever plan I have, if I'm still doing the same plan next year, then I failed, because I failed to adapt, because there's no way things would have stood still for an entire year in the world of cyber. So agility and agile operating models, a focus on business risk scenarios, residual risk, the ability to pivot are all really important. The mindset, not only across my peers, but also within technology, within the cyber team, has to change as well. So for example, there was a time when if you asked people in the cybersecurity team what their job was, they would have said something like, well, our job is to secure the company, make sure things are safe, something like that. And that's not their job. Well, it's not completely their job. Their real job is to facilitate the business in a secure way. Because the first sort of definition could propagate certain behaviors that aren't consistent with what we need to do as an organization. Shutting down e-commerce would make us a lot safer. None of that pesky PII data floating around and credit card information and transactions that could be hijacked. You know, just get rid of it all. Just shut it down. In fact, why not shut down the stores as well? That just creates more risk. That does not help the business though. And so when you start to think about this, you go, okay, my job isn't just to make things safe, because there's lots of ways to shut things down and say what we can't do. Our job is to say, okay, how do I make the business even better, but do it in a way that's secure? And so that small little shift has a big impact in terms of mindset and what we need to do, and creates the alignment across the business that they know we get it. Our job isn't just to shut you down and say no. Our job is to help you, but make sure we help the corporation as a whole.
Well, that is a fantastic analogy. And I'm thinking about the car analogy. And again, like, you know, how cars make improvements all the time. If you're now looking to change lanes, you get a little beep, you don't do it, you know, all of that stuff. So it's ever evolving. Since we're talking about Canadian Tire anyway.
That's awesome. I love it.
Well, I really wanted to thank you so much for joining me today, Rex, for the CIO Leadership Live Canada discussion. Thank you so much. And if anyone out there is interested in viewing this and learning from this video, please head over to cio.com/CA for more information. Thanks again, Rex.
Thank you.